In the name of the merciful and beneficent God, peace be with you. Hello, assalamu alaikum. I'm your brother in faith, Shabir Ally. Today, I bring you another book review. And the last time I was dealing with a pocket-sized book, and now I go from small to big. Here is a giant-sized book. Now, this book is entitled The Developing Human, Clinically and Oriented Embryology by Dr. Keith L. Moore. And this is the third edition of his book. And this is a particular special edition in that in this edition, we have what is called the Islamic Additions, with Islamic Additions by Dr. Abdul Majeed al-Zindani. Now, what they have done here is that they've taken Dr. Moore's original book on embryology, which looks like any other book on embryology, and they have at certain junctures inserted new pages appropriately numbered to mark off these additions as additions into the original book in order to give us references from the Quran and the hadith that deal with the subject matter at hand. So, for example, here we have on page what is called 140A, a quotation from a hadith which is given in Arabic. So we have then basically the 140th page of the original book left undisturbed is still numbered 140. And we have the 140A, which marks it off as an addition into the original work. These are the Islamic additions. Now, why have the authors done this? Why have they inserted these additions? Because there is a lot of correlation to be found between modern discoveries in the field of embryology, the study of the growth and development of the human embryo, and things which are mentioned in the Quran to an amazing degree. In fact, some of the things which apparently were not known before the discovery of the microscope and its use in studying this subject are mentioned in the Quran in a way that would show that this really, for Muslims, this is the word of God. So I want to look at page 8 of this book, Dr. Keith Moore's original work, which gives us some historical gleanings. So he tells us a long time ago, people did not have the detailed knowledge that we have now of embryology, which is obvious enough. What he points out is that the famous Greek physician of the 5th century BC, Hippocrates, wrote, take 20 or more eggs and let them be incubated for two or more hens, incubated by two or more hens. Then each day, from the second to that of hatching, remove an egg, break it and examine it. You will find exactly as I say, for the nature of the bird can be likened to that of man. So these were, you know, the earliest kind of historical bits of study that were done, or studies that were done in embryology in history. And he remarks here, many embryologists regard Aristotle as the founder of embryology, despite the fact that he promoted the idea that the embryo developed from a formless mass and resulted from the union of semen with menstrual blood. So Aristotle, great as he was as a philosopher, and though he's regarded as the father of embryology, or the founder of embryology, nonetheless, he had this mistaken idea. And it goes to show how in those centuries, it was easy for people to have these mistaken ideas. And when we come to the Quran, we will see that the Quran has some very precise statements regarding the growth and development of the human embryo. Now, coming to the Middle Ages, he writes, growth of science was slow during the medieval period, and a few high points of embryological investigation undertaken during this age are known to us. It is cited in the Quran, he spells Quran, K-O-R-A-N, so I pronounce it that way. It is cited in the Quran, the holy book of Muslims, that human beings are produced from a mixture of secretions from the male and the female. Several references are made to the creation of a human being from a sperm drop, and it is also suggested that the resulting organism settles in the woman like a seed 6 days after its beginning. The human blastocyst begins to implant about 6 days after fertilization. The Quran also states that the sperm drop develops into a clot of congealed blood, an implanted blastocyst, or a spontaneously aborted conceptus, would resemble a blood clot. Reference is also made to the leech-like appearance of the embryo. The embryo is shown in figure 5-3A is not unlike a leech or a bloodsucker in appearance. And then he gives the illustration, which we could look at the appropriate place. This figure is mentioned here, a figure by number. The embryo is also said to resemble a chewed piece of substance like gum or wood. The somites shown on figure 5-10 somewhat resemble the teeth marks in a chewed substance. And further, he writes on page 9, the developing embryo was considered to become human at 40 to 42 days, and to no longer resemble an animal embryo at this stage. The human embryo begins to acquire human characteristics at this stage, as shown in figure 5.14c. The Quran also states that the embryo develops within three veils of darkness. This probably refers to, and he numbers the three, what could be three veils of darkness, given the Quran's expression. One, the maternal anterior abdominal wall. Two, the uterine wall. And three, the amniochorionic membrane. Space does not permit this discussion of several other interesting references to human prenatal development that appear in the Quran. And then he goes further into the Renaissance period to see how further developments were made. And then the invention of the microscope in the year 1651, at least that's the year when Harvey was able to use it and make further observations with chick embryos. So what does this all mean? For Muslims, this means that the Quran, in describing the growth and development of the human embryo, using those precise terms, saying that God created you from a nutfa, a tiny drop, and then from the nutfa, made you into an alaka, a thing that clings. And then from the alaka, God made you into a mudga, which is like a chewed lump. And then made you into a new creation. That follows exactly the sequence that of developments that modern scientists are aware of. And one might ask, how did this kind of information get into the Quran? But one has to reckon with the fact that the Quran is available for us and has been basically the same for 1400 years. So how did this information get into the Quran? How was this written into the Quran some 1400 years ago when the microscope was invented only a few hundred years ago? How could that information have been attained by human beings? It would seem to Muslims that this is evidence that the Quran is the word of God, because God would have that information, and God would have to put that in a simple way so that people in the 7th century would understand the Quran's message. Basically, the Quran's message is not about science. It's about our humble beginnings and our lowly position in the face of the majestic God, and of course, the majesty of God and the wondrous nature of his creation. All of that is the emphasis of in the Quran. And at the same time, that simple message which was given to the Arabs in the 7th century, some 1400 years ago, is couched in language that would give new insights to our present situation, language that will help people to understand now that the Quran is really referring to things which we are discovering using modern scientific equipment. So for Muslims, there's a lot of reasons to be excited about this. I was excited about this information when I first got hold of it. And I've been using this book again and again, referring to it from time to time. It is a book that I think that Muslims should be proud to obtain and to present as a gift to their non-Muslim friends, or at least to show them that when we speak about the Quran as being the word of Allah Azza wa Jal, there is good reason for believing that. So this is a book that has changed my life. And I hope that it will make an impact on yours as well and on the lives of the people around you. I would highly recommend this book. Is there anything that I didn't like about it? Well, you can buy this book in two forms. You can buy its original form, which is only from Dr. Keith Moore, and you can buy the form which I hold in my hands that has the Islamic edition, editions. Both have their benefits. If you want to give it to somebody as a gift who is not a Muslim, maybe you don't want to give them with the Islamic editions because you don't want them to be confused which one is the original, which one is the edition. and then they get suspicious, it's as if somebody has added something into here to preach a different message. So give them the original one. But for you, as a Muslim, you may want to see the correlation between the scientific statements and the Quran right away. This will be helpful for you to see that all in one volume. So it has changed my life, and I hope that it will make an impact on your life as well. Thank you for watching. I'm your brother in faith, Shabir Ally. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be with you. You can change someone's life this Ramadan. Donate as much or as little as you can and be part of our project to share the message of Islam to people across the globe. Visit QuranSpeaks.com and donate. Your contribution is zakat eligible and tax deductible. May God keep you safe and healthy. May God bless you and your loved ones with the very best always.